Oh, hey, didn't see you there. I was just about to strangle myself a dinosaur. Now, as we went through in a previous episode of Because Science, the last episode, we were saying that the animals in Jurassic Park are not true velociraptor. They are Deinonychus, rather. And so if you had to fight a true velociraptor, it would be a different animal than you see in the films. But that does not mean that we should just throw Deinonychus out the window like a useless dinosaur. Because it is, in fact, one of the most important dinosaur discoveries, Deinonychus is, live. in the entire history of dinosaur paleontology. So, Deinonychus here, correct pronunciation, as many of you have told me, would stand about this height to you. It would be a little bit bigger, its body and its head would, but, you know, scale, not to scale, I'm actually huge, it's small. So it would come up to about here, and it would probably be feathered, and it would look like a beautiful little murder turkey. Now, it is not the scaly beast that we see in the Jurassic Park films, but again, it is very important. And we should give Michael Crichton his due because when he was researching the novels and the movies came out, Deinonychus was actually classified in the genus Velociraptor. So technically, Deinonychus was a Velociraptor, and then it was reclassified later to be a separate dinosaur. So it was Velociraptor at the time, so he was technically accurate. Now, this beast has been described as the single most important dinosaur discovery of the mid-20th century. It was first described, and the fossils were discovered and described by a paleontologist named Ostrom. And why this dinosaur was so important is because Deinonychus, its skeleton seemed like the skeleton of an agile, mobile hunter. And seeing skeleton like that kind of contradicted a common sense kind of wisdom that dinosaurs were slow, lumbering, reptilian beasts. Rather, Deinonychus suggested that these dinosaurs could be perhaps warm-blooded and reignited argument for warm-blooded dinosaurs and even feathered dinosaurs. That's maybe the most important application of this fossil because look at the morphologies of the bones between something like an Archaeopteryx, which is a transitional fossil that we found between modern-day birds and dinosaurs, and the same bones from the same parts of the body from Deinonychus here. They are almost identical. This went on to be one of the key linchpin pieces in the argument that birds, modern-day birds, are dinosaurs, and that's where we got birds from. So even though this animal is not technically anymore a velociraptor, Deinonychus, like you see in the films, just scalier, is one of the most important dinosaurs ever. So let's just take a second to remember it. You're just a lovely, ow! Just kidding. Hello, and welcome to another edition of Because Science Live, the live component of this channel where I take all of your nerdy comments, questions, and corrections and try to answer them off the top of my well-argonoiled head. And if I don't know something, I don't know something. But I know a little bit about a lot of science and nerdy stuff, so consider me your geeky portal to the pop culture universe. I have Nate here somewhere.
I'm somewhere.
There, you're hilarious. What do we got?
From Evla1010.
Okay.
Hey, Kyle. Love the show.
Thank you.
Do you think that it's possible to bring the dinosaurs back? If so, do you think it'd be a good idea?
So the problem with trying to bring a dinosaur back is what you see in the films is that they have dino DNA, right? Right? And dinosaur DNA, getting it from something like amber, is great in theory. But in practice, there's a constraint on getting this. So like some radioactive elements, DNA has a half-life, meaning that over time, DNA will degrade some amount. So, you know, it'll be destroyed by time and exposure and all that stuff, you know, just being in the elements, you know, it'll be half destroyed in X amount of time. Now, it just so happens that half-life is relatively short. Which means it's in the few tens of thousands of years, hundreds of thousands of years, and not millions or tens of millions of years. So dinosaurs died out 65 million years ago with a giant impactor. And, well, that was part of it. Anyway, there's new science about it. Anyway, DNA degrades over time, and that time happens pretty quickly for DNA, and so you cannot actually get DNA that would be 100% intact, or even a significant percentage intact from dinosaurs, considering that the earliest ones we can get are 65 million years ago. Even if those dinosaurs were 1 million years old, the DNA would probably be degraded beyond repair. So just getting DNA that's almost complete, and you could just fill in with frog DNA or whatever the movies say, that is extremely unlikely. But the DNA is not the only part of the equation. What we are talking about here is called de-extinction, and it's a field of study that's pretty hot right now, and you've probably heard it in relation to something like the woolly mammoth. So getting, and we have woolly mammoth DNA that isn't degraded too bad, and we still don't have woolly mammoths. So that gives you an idea that there's something else to this, that it's harder than just getting the DNA, because we have woolly mammoth DNA. What is the next step? Well, we would have to insert that DNA into an applicable egg that's fertilized, and then put it into an animal that could birth a dinosaur, or a dinosaur-like thing. Now, for the woolly mammoth, that seems more feasible. You could get an elephant, a kind of elephant, to possibly birth a woolly mammoth, because the biologies are close-ish. But we need to find something to birth a dinosaur. Would that be a bird? I don't know. I'm not up to date on the current de-extinction for dinosaur research, but I know that getting a dinosaur or any extinct animal born just from DNA is extremely difficult. We actually did this once, though. I believe the animal was an ibex. And with science, we reached our hands back through the past, and we pulled an animal out of extinction, and we brought it back to life for a few minutes. We were able to birth an extinct ibex through a related animal, and it survived for a few minutes, but its lungs were misformed, and it died. That's amazing in and of itself, but the animal perished very, very quickly, and it took dozens of eggs and dozens of tries for this to even happen. So there are many roadblocks to getting a dinosaur back to life. It's not just the DNA thing. The more promising, promising is a loaded term, but maybe the more actionable research is the guy who Alan Grant in the movies is based on, Jack Horner. He is involved in research that is creating like a chickenosaurus. And what the idea is that there is still some dinosaur-related traits and genes in modern dinosaur DNA, birds. And so the thinking goes is that if you could go into a chicken's DNA and flip all those genetic switches that have been turned off by time and evolution, you might get something like a chicken to express the traits of of its ancestors, something like a dinosaur. I believe we've given chicken embryos teeth with this method. So extrapolating, there might be a way in the future to take a chicken embryo or a bird embryo and flip enough genetic switches, which is a grand oversimplification, of course, flip a few genetic switches and turn it into something like a chickenosaurus, or something that looks much more dinosaurian. So, going back to your question, what is the feasibility of Jurassic Park style bringing something back to life? Very, very unlikely, at least with current technology, based on the roadblocks that we know. We already have woolly mammoth DNA, and I think in full, and we still can't do it. And we have things that are like woolly mammoths still kicking around. So, very unlikely. I would keep an eye on the Chickenosaurus research. Search Chickenosaurus and Jack Horner, and you might get some of that research pulled up on your internet electric machine, as the kids call it. I asked him once during an interview, if you could bring any animal back and you could genetically engineer it, what would you do? And he said he would have a giant, fully feathered, completely pink, like a parrot, Tyrannosaurus Rex. So that's where his head's at. What's next?
From that dude.
Man, I had a lot to say about that dude.
From that dude.
That dude. What you got to say, Maya?
Is it possible to punch someone in the chest over their heart and the punch simply stops their heart?
I don't know. I don't know. I'm not a medical professional, but I think there's probably I think there's probably some relation between direct impact over the heart or near the heart and possible fibrillations of the heart, which is you can get the heart to skip a beat or something to go wrong in the heart, basically. And so there's probably some link there, but I would have no idea how to calculate how much force that would take or even if that's a thing. Do you know what I mean? It might be just a range of impacts and not a specific force value, or so many other things would have to be in play. Maybe you'd have to have a genetic predisposition to those kind of things happening in your heart. Man, so many of you have so many problems with how I pronounce words, like Deinonychus, that now I'm getting in my own head about it. So, I think you could probably punch someone hard enough in the chest to make bad things happen to their heart. How much force that would take? No idea. What's next?
From Jason LeClaire.
Yeah?
Why does water expand when it becomes ice?
I'm sure there's a more complicated physics explanation for this, but I'm not a physicist. What I do know is that when H2O molecules, let's just say here, when H2O molecules rearrange themselves in, let's say ice, of course, that's your question. So they're very close together in liquid form. But this, and I apologize, some of you have told me that I simplify your questions too much. Sorry, if I do that, it's my basic understanding of what your question is. And also, it's very hard to sound intelligent live for 30 minutes off the top of your head, so deal with it. So when ice forms, the molecules, the bonds that they make with each other, loosely speaking, between hydrogen and, you know, partial bonding with hydrogen and oxygen and stuff, the distance between them is slightly larger, and that causes a slight increase in the amount of volume per mass, and that decreases the density. Yes, it decreases the density, and that's why ice floats on top of water. And that is, again, I'm simplifying here, but the molecules, when they arrange themselves in a more crystalline structure, they push themselves further apart than they otherwise would be in the liquid form. Almost no other substance that we know of, I don't know any off the top of my head, does this. That's what makes water so unique. And just think of, if this wasn't the case, how radically different life would change on Earth if we'd have life at all. Think of if oceans froze from the bottom up, instead of having a protective layer of ice through which it's very hard for heat to flow into the bottom of the oceans. That kind of protects the oceans from freezing over, if it could. So life would be so much different if water was different. That's why water's so interesting. It's the stuff of life! And it's just a happenstance of physics. We're accidents! What's next?
From Dex Wild.
Oh, we'll see.
Hey Kyle, my kids and I are big fans of the show.
Oh, thank you so much.
My daughter wants to know, how long would it take the Earth to be livable after a dino extinction meteor hit the Earth again?
Wow. How long would it take after a dinosaur killer, so to speak, came down to Earth, raining fire and debris across the entire planet? I don't know. I'm sorry not to answer your question directly. I don't know what the actual timeline is before we could live again. I know that the impact is so incredibly mind-bendingly big that it'd be hard for us to survive the impact in the first place. No matter how long it takes for the Earth to become survivable again, I'm not sure we would survive the impact. And I heard this described. Oh, I forget the article or the book this was in, but I heard this described recently. And this impact was so immense, what was the quote? It was lovely. It was, it'd be like a normal day on the Yucatan Peninsula, and then the next moment the world ends. Like, literally, the next moment the world ends. That was the scale of this impact. It was so big. Some scientists think that there are bits of dinosaur bone on the moon, if that helps you put it in perspective. So if you can eject living things on the Earth with such force that it, you know, goes out into space, if this hit a a highly, a densely populated area, if this hit the United States, we'd probably be gone. And I've seen, and maybe your kids don't want to listen to this part, but I've seen reports from atomic researchers and, threat assessment government dudes that say one well-placed nuclear bomb, say in New York or something like that, would probably lead to the biggest biggest global disaster in human history. The amount of money and resources, time loss, unlivable areas, it would be the worst thing to ever happen to humanity. Now scale that up to KT extinction levels. I don't know if we're making it. Probably not. We'd have to live underground. Maybe that's where I am. Yeah, who knows? What's next?
From Jacob Taylor.
Hello, Jacob.
What is the most scientifically accurate movie that deals with dinosaurs?
That's a hard question, because Jurassic Park is such a monumental piece of pop culture. Other movies don't even try to get in its territory, because they know that's the instant comparison. There's been animated movies of dinosaurs and crappy B movies with dinosaurs and puppets in them, but no one really tries to do a AAA release with dinosaurs in them, because Jurassic Park kind of has that market cornered. So, that being said, Jurassic Park kind of has to be the most scientifically accurate dinosaur film that I know of, because of the number of things that it was trying to get right. Someone pointed out in the comments of the most recent video, something that I liked a lot, is that we can't really hold the filmmakers as accountable as people often do for science that wasn't established yet. At the time of filming and writing his novels, Michael Crichton thought that Deinonychus was actually a velociraptor, and it was, and then it was changed later. Can't really fault him for that. And when he was writing the novels, he contacted Ostrom, the paleontologist who discovered Deinonychus, and he asked for all of his papers on it. He wanted to get the science as accurate as possible. And remember what we said about this inspiring more conversation for the link between dinosaurs and birds. Well, why weren't the dinosaurs in Jurassic Park, the original, 1993, feathered? Well, that wasn't really established, an established scientific consensus right then when the movie came out. So we can't really fault those that first movie for leaving that kind of stuff out. And the fact that it was talking about, there's DNA damage, so you have to replace it with other similar DNA. The fact that I think Alan Grant even mentions they move like birds, they were like birds. That's hinting at the research that went into this. The later movies, the Jurassic World movies, are they play faster and looser with the science, but they can have their own cop-outs, right? If they just say, look, and they say this, it's kind of meta in the film, in the first one. They say, look, people expect scaly monsters, so we use genetic engineering and that's what we gave them. That's why they're not feathered. All right. I mean, from a narrative perspective, that works. It's kind of a loaded question, but Jurassic Park, the original, probably then has to be the most scientifically accurate dinosaur film, or at least the one to do it best that I know of. I can't think of any other dinosaur films off the top of my head. Yes, I can. That aren't animated films. Yes, I can. Future War, which they did on Mystery Science Theater 3000. You should watch that one. What's next?
From Jared Sheff.
It's not scientifically accurate. They were, whatever. They're puppets.
My six-year-old Max would like to know.
Hello, Max.
What's the tallest building we can build? Would it reach into space?
Oh, man. What's the tallest building that we can build? I believe the tallest building right now is the Burj Khalifa, which is over a kilometer high, kilometer and a half, something like that. Very, very tall, mind-bendingly tall. I don't know what the actual limit is on getting a building up into the atmosphere. The most scrapiest skyscraper. I don't know what that is, but I know it will be materials limited. So at a certain point, when you are building, let's say, when you're building a building, at a certain point, you will start to exceed the material strength for the materials that you're using. So as this gets taller and taller, it's gonna get heavier and heavier, right, Max? And so at the bottom, there's gonna be more and more force. from all that heaviness that you're putting on top of it. And the more you do this, at the bottom, it's gonna have to support more and more weight, which means if you're using the same materials, you might have to extend this way out and make the base of it, this isn't accurate, but you know, absolutely huge to support all the weight that you're trying to put on top of the building and make the biggest skyscraper. So at some point, you're gonna create this monstrosity that starts to look like a pyramid that's base is way wider, and it's going up higher and higher and higher and higher, and then it's gonna get so big that you're gonna have to, you know, level whole cities, like, get out of the way, I'm trying to make the biggest building! I don't know, what's the biggest skyscraper that looks like a traditional skyscraper? That's gonna be limited by the material strength of stuff like steel and iron and other things that they're using. But the biggest building possible, period, would be this giant, have a giant footprint, have a giant foundation, then kind of go up to a point at the very top. I do not know how tall that is, but getting into space, probably not, because you're talking about then going at least to the Kármán line, which is where we loosely define space as, at 100 kilometers in the air. 100,000 meters into the air. So Max, that is very, very, very high. In fact, the air up here is so thin, if these are, you know, giant air molecules, which I'm just using to show you, if these are giant air molecules, up here, up at this limit, you can't breathe. You need a pressure suit to not die. You need oxygen. The restraints on a building up that high get even worse. When you get up just, you know, 10 kilometers, it's negative 50 degrees outside Celsius, which is so cold if you spit in front of your face, it would snap, crap, crackle, and pop, like that cereal you might eat. You're a kid, so... Biggest building, I don't know. A lot of challenges, though. What's next?
From Data Bing.
Data Bing, oh!
Do you have any advice on how to understand world lines?
Okay. So a Data Bing, oh, I don't know if that's offensive, is asking about is a very complicated concept in physics called world lines, which is describing three dimensions of space plus time and your path through space-time over time. And I don't even know if I'm going to be able to draw this right now, just freehand for y'all. But if you're talking about world lines, you can use the speed of light to... Yes. And we're suppressing one spatial dimension here. So imagine these two crosses. There's three dimensions of space in there. And then there's one dimension of time. So now, this is all... See how complicated this is already? Now, if we define the speed of light in this graph, you can get what is called a light cone of all the possible events that could happen according to the speed of light. So the fastest something you could go, like you, the fastest you could possibly go, which you can't, is the speed of light. So if you graph the speed of light and distance over time, get the speed of light in a graph, but this is in three dimensions, but it's one that is suppressed so you can see it, then you get a three-dimensional cone where all possible events, future and past, can happen for you. And so all events that will happen for you will occur inside of light cones just like this, through space and through time. So this is the present, right here in the exact center, let's say the origin here. That's the present, that is now, which you don't live in because your brain, but we can get into that later. And then these are the three dimensions of space. Anything outside of the light cone is called elsewhere. Ooh, nothing, you cannot reach it ever. Maybe. And so getting back to your question, this red line here is your world line. All of the events that will happen to you in your past and future goes along this line. So this is describing not only your travel through three-dimensional space, but as it moves, you're traveling through time on the Earth, in the galaxy, whatever, as it moves. This is your light cone. Every single thing that you will ever do or be is on this line. It starts when you were conceived or born. It's going to end when you end. And then everything you've ever done compressed down to a single line in space. What do you want your world line to be? Whoo! Ooh, that got heavy. What's next? I'm very impressed with myself that I did that off the top of my head. I'm not a physicist. That's not bad. Look up world lines. It's very complicated. And if you're sorry, Nate, I didn't mean to. But if you're more interested in this kind of physics, check out physicist Sean Carroll on Twitter. He tweets a lot about it, and he has a recent book that's very good called The Big Picture. I would highly recommend that book by Sean Carroll. You're welcome, Sean. It's nice. Sorry, Nate.
From
Nate.
Mirix Bob.
Okay. Thank goodness you're still here.
Is there a limit to how much thermal energy a piece of mass can have?
How hot can something get? Is that what you're asking me? Instead of getting like theoretical, like what's the hottest possible temperature, which I don't know, and I don't know if there is a hottest possible temperature. I'm sure there's some poorly made video on YouTube about it. You know those YouTube videos that are just like, just slides of pictures and they have like 10 million views and they're really, it's a really crappy VO. That's what I'm fighting against. What was your question? Oh yeah, is there a limit to how hot a material can get? Well, let's do this practically. I'm sorry if I'm simplifying your question, but practically speaking, if you want something to be like steel, if you get it to a certain temperature, if it has enough thermal energy, it will start to change into another form of that. Steel will start to bend at a certain temperature and then fail, and then it will melt at another temperature, higher temperature, and then at even higher temperature, it will vaporize. And at that point, when you turn steel into gas, I'm pretty sure that's about all the heat that that material can take. If your question is to mean, is there an upper limit on temperature, period, I do not know. There's a lower limit, absolute zero, but the highest limit, I don't know, but before you get to the highest possible theoretical temperature in physics, the material that you are concerned with will be destroyed or turn into a substance that has no resemblance to that original material. That's what I would say.
One more.
Last
one. Oh. From Woody 2015.
Oh.
What dinosaur
Toy
is your
Story
favorite?
One? What?
What dinosaur is your favorite?
What dinosaur is my favorite? I was obsessed with dinosaurs as a kid. I watched Jurassic Park 100 times. Totally holds up today, by the way, because of their use of animatronics and practical effects. I had dinosaur CD-ROMs that I'd play on the computer. CD-ROMs, remember those? I'd go to museums and look at dinosaurs. I do not know if I have a favorite. T-Rex isn't, Tyrannosaurus Rex is an easy choice. Diplodocus, some of these dinosaurs, Dilophosaurus, because I like to say it, the dinosaur that spits venom in Jurassic Park, but there's no evidence that it ever spit venom, but Dilophosaurus was really interesting. I used to watch kids' movies with dinosaurs in them. Anyway, I don't know if I can pick a favorite. Ankylosaurus was always pretty dope, because he, big tail, just whacking things around. But I'd probably stick to around the favorites. And other ancient animals that I was obsessed with that are still alive today, like Nautilus and stuff, which pump water into the chambers of their Nautilus so they can rise and sink in the water, like submarines. They're ancient little animals that can't see where they're going, so they bump into stuff. I love them. I hope that answers your question, at least partly. Thank you for watching another edition of Because Science Live. Woo! Another week down. Thank you for watching the last episode. Thank you all of you who are commenting on it. There's so many good comments. I learned a lot from you dino nerds, especially about Michael Crichton and why he chose Deinonychus and Velociraptor and all those things. Some of you asked me how quickly or how many comments do I read before I put any of them in the other show footnotes. And I would say I get about 5 to 6 hours after the video releases, and I will read every single comment. You see me in there, so get in there, get quick, get nerdy. I hope you have a wonderful rest of your weekend. And in case, we could be annihilated tomorrow. Well, astronomers would detect it. Anyway, in case something terrible happens, live life kindly, because this is all we got.